हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, माय सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स टुडे। टुडे यू हैव 27th of January 2021 एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर करंट अफेयर्स। ऑलराइट, सो हियर बेसिकली वी आर रेफरिंग द टू नेशनल न्यूज़पेपर्स। द फर्स्ट इज द हिंदू एंड द सेकेंड इज इंडियन एक्सप्रेस। All right, both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer both of these newspapers, as both of these newspapers basically exhaustively covers your daily current affairs, which are generally asked in the various government competitive examinations. This lecture will also be useful for UPSC civil services examination, right? So you must refer the Hindu newspaper for this, and you can also refer to our channel, the Future IAS, for your daily current affairs. All right, so let's begin with the lecture. All right. So the first news is basically the Dhannipur Mosque. Okay. So Dhannipur Mosque project is basically, you know, you might have aware about the verdict or verdict of Babri Masjid, right? Which has been, you know, given by the Honorable Supreme Court of India. So which has given, you know, the original land for, you know, for the construction of the Ram temple. Simultaneously asked the UP government to allot 5 acres of the land, right? Nearby to that, you know, the original site for the construction of a mosque, which was there at the place of the Ram temple, right? So here, the Dhannipur Mosque project is basically related to that verdict of the Supreme Court, right? According to that verdict, right, the UP government has to give 5 acres plot for the construction of the mosque nearby to that locality. All right. So here, the Dhannipur is the village of Ayodhya district in the Uttar Pradesh. So 5 acres land have been given to the mosque where the mosque will be constructed. All right. So here, you know, the mosque project was formally launched on the Republic Day, right? It was launched on the Republic Day on a piece of land, which is 5 acres for the construction of this mosque. Okay, so this plot, as I told you, this plot was allotted by the Uttar Pradesh government, all right, because as the Supreme Court basically, you know, gave its verdict to allot the 5 acres of the land for the construction of, you know, this mosque, all right, in the Babri Masjid Ram Janmabhoomi title suit, all right. And you must understand regarding construction, right, the Indo-Islamic Cultural Foundation would basically oversee the construction related activities of the mosque. So it will oversee all sort of a construction and, you know, the architectural related framework of the mosque. Okay. This project would be completed in around 30 months. So it has the time period of 30 months to be completed. And this project basically comprises of 3 parts. Okay. So this project will have 3 parts. The first one is basically mosque. So a mosque will be constructed. It will be based on the modern design. All right. And the second is basically a hospital, which is 200 bed multi-speciality hospital would also be constructed in this 5 acres of the land. And also simultaneously a community kitchen would also be constructed, right? And an Indo-Islamic cultural research center would also be set up in this 5 acres of the land. So here it will have the 3 parts. The first part is basically the mosque based on the modern design. Second is basically a community kitchen plus the 200 bed, you know, the multi-speciality hospital. And the third is basically a research center, which is based on the Indo-Islamic cultural aspect. All right. So these 3 parts will be constructed as a part of your mosque. All right. So this is basically, you know, a design for the mosque, which will be constructed, right, in this place. All right. Next is basically Govind Vallabh Pant. So all of you would have been aware about this Govind Vallabh Pant. He was basically a freedom fighter, right? And he was also a member of Legislative Assembly in the pre-independent India, right? So he was basically, you know, a great freedom fighter, which basically gave a lot of its effort to make our country independent. So why his, you know, the name is in the figure or in the news? So here, the statue of the Govind Vallabh Pant have been removed from the parliamentary premises, right? So this statue of the Govind Vallabh Pant, which was removed, and which will be, you know, which would be, you know, located or which will be unveiled in a new location. So here, instead of the parliamentary premises, right, his statue would be unveiled in a new location, and this new location would be, you know, you might have seen also this Gurudwara Rakabganj. It is very famous in Delhi, nearby your the parliamentary house itself. All right, so here a roundabout is there. Okay, the roundabout. So in that roundabout, right, the statue of the Govind Ballabh Pant would be situated or would be unveiled. So here the new location for the statue of Govind Ballabh Pant would be relocated, right, to a roundabout opposite to the Gurudwara Rakabganj, basically, which is located on the Pandit Pant Mark in Delhi. So the Pandit Govind Ballabh Pant basically was born in 1887 and he died in 1961, and he was basically a lawyer and Indian freedom fighter, right? And he was also one of the architects of modern India. And as I told you, he was also a member of Legislative Assembly. So he was basically elected to the Legislative Assembly of the United Province of Agra and the Aud in 1921. So he was also a member of Legislative Assembly. And he was also actively participated in the non-cooperation movement, right? As well as in the civil disobedience movement, which was started in the pre-independent era, right? And also he was also a member of Central Legislative Assembly, as well as the Constituent Assembly, which was set up, right, in 1946 for framing of our new constitution for the independent India. So he was the member of that Constituent Assembly also, and he was the member of Central Legislative Assembly also. And as soon as the India became independent, right, he was also served as the first Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh from 1950 to 1954. That means he was the first Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh from 1950 to 1954. And also, he also served as the second Chief Minister of United Province from 1937 to 1939, right? Which later he basically served the first Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh from 50 to 54. So he, you see, basically he is the basically Govind Ballabh Pant. He was basically a freedom fighter. He was also a politician because he held the several posts like the membership in the Legislative Assembly, the membership in the Central Legislative Assembly, right? He was also the member of the Constituent Assembly, and he served as the Chief Minister of, or the first Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh from 50 to 54. So he was a politician also. And he died on March 7, 1961. He was the first CM of Uttar Pradesh. And right, as he was also the holding of Union Home Minister, right? And he was also imprisoned several times during his, you know, the support to the, you know, for freedom fighting, right? And he was honored to Bharat Ratna in 1957. All right. So you see, basically here, he served as the Union Home Minister from 1955 to 61. Okay. So he was basically instrumental in the reorganization of the states. Okay. So that was, the issue basically in 1950s when the many states basically demanding of the reorganization of the states based on the linguistic criteria or based on the language criteria. Okay. Various, committees have been set up. The most prominent committee is JVP committee. Okay, that is Jawaharlal Nehru, Vallabhbhai Patel, and Pattabhi Sitaramaiah, JVP committee. This committee basically recommended, not to reorganize the state based on the linguistic criteria. So this committee basically gave, a recommendation against this linguistic-based reorganization of the states. Then a Fazal Ali committee was set up. Okay, this Fazal Ali committee was set up, and this committee first time recognized or gave recommendation to reorganize the states based on the linguistic criteria, and henceforth the State Reorganization Act, State Reorganization Act was basically passed in 1956, and ultimately the reorganization was done, right? And at that point of the time, he was basically the Home Minister. So he served the Union Home Minister from 1955 to 1961. So he was basically instrumental figure, right? Especially in the reorganization of the state based on the linguistic criteria. All right. And he was also responsible for establishment of Hindi as an official language of the central government as well as the few states. Okay. And for his contribution, right, for his exemplary service to the nation, he was basically received the Bharat Ratna in 1957. So he was awarded the Bharat Ratna in 1957. All right. Let's understand our third news, that is data privacy. That is data privacy. So here you must understand the data is something which is related to your, you know, your digital transactions, right? So wherever you transact digitally, right, you basically gave some of your data regarding your, you know, regarding your identity, regarding your name, regarding your, you know, various identity proofs, your phone number, right, your address proofs, and a lot of other things, PAN card, a lot of other things will be also be shared, right? Now, what happens is, including your bank details, now what happens is, this data privacy is one of the most important concern for every government in the world, okay? Because right to privacy was recently recognized by the Honorable Supreme Court of India as our fundamental right. So data privacy is also most important aspect. So here, right, the report or the study conducted by the Competition Commission of India has found that the data privacy now can take a form of non-price competition. Okay, so it is the term that basically used, right, for the data privacy. So which can take in the form of the non-price competition. And there may be possibility that there is an abuse of this dominance, whoever the players who would basically dominate in this market. So it's quite possibility that, you know, the some sort of a, you know, the abuse would be done, and that will definitely lowers the privacy protection. So ultimately, this form of non-price competition will ultimately reduce the privacy protection to the general public. Okay, so here the Competition Commission of India basically noted the various aspects in the context of the competition, especially in the digital communication or the digital transactions, right, which are basically conflict between, you know, you have the two sides. First is basically you allow the access to your basically to your consumer, right, or your customer, and the second side you have to protect the consumer's privacy also. So there is a continuous conflict, or there is, you know, trade-off between them, right? You need to give the access and you need to protect their privacy also. So, right, so in the context of this competition, especially in the digital era, especially in the digital communications, right, the Competition Commission of India basically has published its one of the study. Here, you know, the form of non-price competition, basically you can see basically here what will happen in terms of this, you know, non-price competition, right? The abuse of the dominance, right, that can take in the form of, for example, lowering of privacy protection, right? So here what happens is that process will ultimately lowers your privacy protection, and that will fall, right, in the ambit of antitrust, right? As you know, the low privacy standard implies the lack of consumer welfare. So ultimately what will happen is the lowering of your privacy protection ultimately leads to, right, the lack of consumer welfare, and which is basically not good for the democracy, because democracy stand on the consumer welfare, right? If the data is not sufficiently protected, if data is, right, if the privacy, right, can take in the form of non-price competition, right, the welfare measures for the common public cannot be ensured or cannot be restored, right? So here what will happen is some of the non-price factors, like in the non-price competition, it is here. So some of the non-price factors such as the quality of the service may be lowered, right? So that may happen that over the period of the time, right, a quality of the service may be lower, right? The data speed may get affected, may get lowered. Bundled offering may be provided, right? So these are some of the non-price factors, right? Or some of the service provider may give you good quality of the service. Some of them may not give you, right? Some of will give you, you know, good data speeds. Others may not give you good data speeds. So that may have some sort of a non-price factors, right? And such non-price competition will ultimately, right, what will happen? The new drivers of the competitive rivalry between the service providers would be taken place, right? So here the new rivalry will be there, which will be there in the form of your quality of the service, or which will be impacting your quality of the service or data speeds, or offering you some sort of a bundled, you know, the access to the internet, right? All such things will ultimately lead to the lowering of your privacy. All right, next, the intergovernmental negotiation framework. So first of all, let's understand that there is, you know, the Intergovernmental Negotiation Framework Group. This group basically consists of the nation states or the sovereign nations, right, from all over the world. Why this intergovernmental negotiations framework group have been set up? So this have been set up especially in the context of the reforming of United Nations Security Council. All right. So which is basically an organ of the United Nations, right? So here to reform the United Nations Security Council, an intergovernmental negotiation framework group was set up. And this intergovernmental negotiation framework group is nothing but a group of nation states, right, which are part of the United Nations, right? The ultimate aim of this setting up of this IGN group is to basically reform the United Nations Security Council, right? So that the new entrant can also be part of the five permanent members. So you might be aware about this. There are five permanent members, or there are total 15 members, right? Among them, five are the permanent members. These five permanent members are having veto power, right? So there are five permanent members in the United Nations Security Council, and in these five permanent members, right, they have the veto power, right? So these group of the states, or some of the nation states, basically try to reform this structure of the United Nations Security Council so that other nations can also participate, right? And also they are demanding for giving this veto power to the non-permanent members also, right? So here the India's permanent representative to the UN, which is Ambassador T.S. Trimurti, right, recently said that it is nearly 13 years since the intergovernmental negotiation have been started, but there is no such consensus or there is no such outcome, right? So the United Nations Security Council is unable to act effectively on this, the intergovernmental negotiations, right, to address some of the pressing issues like international peace and security, right? Because according to the Indian ambassador, right, or the India's permanent representative to the UN, right, T.S. Trimurti, that because the United Nations Security Council lacks inclusivity, right? So here the most important aspect is basically to reform the United Nations Security Council so that it can act, or it can act effectively to address some of the most pressing issues like international peace and the security. All right. A composition of the Intergovernmental Negotiations Framework Group. So you see, basically, the composition is basically several, international organizations, right? Or it has several international organizations. The international organization definitely consisting of the states or the nation states. So you see here, it consisting of the African Union, it consisting of the group or G4 nations, right? Which include the India, Brazil, Japan, and the Germany, right? These four nations, the India is the largest democracy in the world. The Brazil is also, the emerging country. The Japan is industrialized country. And the Germany is also superpower. So both of the, all of these four countries are basically pressing for a permanent seat in the reform United Nations Security Council, right? And there are also the Uniting for the Consensus Group, which is also called Coffee Club, which is also a part of IGN. Right, there is L69 group, which is basically consisting of the developing country, which is also part of IGN group. Then you have the Arab League, which is also pressing for the reforming of United Nations Security Council, as well as the Caribbean Community, which is also pressing for this. Okay, now obviously, because there are a lot of multiple groups which are involved here, so there will be lot of different set of positions which will be holding here. So each of these groups basically have slightly different demands. That is quite obvious for reforming the United Nations Security Council, right? So these demands are basically, are sometime there is no convergence between these demands. So what happens is, in 2016, a oral decision was adopted by United Nations General Assembly, right? This oral decision is basically, based on, certain set of consensus, right? So which ultimately gave its approval also for the declaration, which is also known as element of convergence, right? So which basically outlined some sort of a consensus, which is basically reached by the members of these, or consensus basically reached among the members of this IGN groups, right? Which is also known as element of convergence. All right. So here you must understand, because as I told you that five permanent members are having, veto power, but others non-permanent member does not have this veto power, and there is a legitimate right for the largest democracy like India to become a part of the permanent member of the United Nations Security Council, or at least to give a veto power to the India also, which is also fastly emerging. All right, next. So Palestine, first of all, it's a country, right? Especially in the Western Asia. So what happens is, you might have heard about the Donald Trump, who was the 45th president of United States of America, right? The Donald Trump basically snapped, you know, almost all relationship with the Palestine, right? And also it overturned, or the United, or the Donald Trump basically cut off, you know, some sort of a, you know, the aid which is to be provided, right? So here what happens is, the new president of the United States, which is basically 46th president of the United States of America, Joe Biden, right, which announced, you know, restoring this broken relationship with the Palestinians, right? And the Joe Biden administration also renewing the aid to the Palestinians refugees, right? So here the aid will be given, as well as the restoring of the relationship with the Palestinians is the most important context in the news of Palestine with the United States of America. So here, some of its policies of the Joe Biden basically is a reversal of the Donald Trump administration's policies, which were basically, you know, implemented by the Donald Trump. So here, the most important key element of this new support is basically a two-state solution, right? So their two-state solution is basically the Palestine, right? And you're basically Israel, right? So Israel, so Palestine and Israel, they are basically two-state solution, which basically, you know, decades old conflict between these two nations, right? And the most important point here is that Palestine have already been recognized as, you know, as the sovereign entity. So it is already recognized officially as the state of Palestine by the United Nations, as well as other entities. All right. And as the Palestine is basically a sovereign state in the Western Asia, right, which basically claims the Western Bank, because the few portion of the Western Bank is also occupied by the Israel. So it basically claimed the Western Bank, which is nothing but bordering. I will show you the map, right, after a few minutes. So the Western Bank basically, you know, borders Israel and Jordan, and few portion is also occupied by the Israel. The Gaza Strip also, which borders the Israel and the Egypt, right? All right. The Palestine has its capital with the Jerusalem as, you know, the design capital, right, as well as administrative center, which is located as Ramallah, right? So there is a fight for this, you know, for this Jerusalem, because both, you know, Palestine and Israel basically fought for this land, and right, and some of these territories which are basically, you know, illegally captured by the Israel, as stated by the Palestine, right? So some of the territory which are claimed by the state of Palestine is occupied by the Israel, right, since 1948 itself. So this territory, which was first occupied by the Egypt, then Jordan, and from the Jordan, it has been taken over by the Israel after six-day war in 1967. So you see the map here. So this is the Palestine, you see, right? Here you have the West Bank, right? And here you have the Israel, it is the Gaza Strip, right? And some of the, you know, the adjacent countries like Egypt, Jordan, Syria, right? Lebanon, right? And here you have the Mediterranean Sea. All right. So it is a political map for your Palestine and Israel. All right. Let's understand the new news, that is Gallantry Awards. Okay. So what happens is, every year, the President of India basically approve certain awards, which will be awarded by the President of India itself, right? And certain Gallantry Award, which to be awarded every year during the Independence Day, as well as during, you know, Republic Day. So this year, the President of India approved the 455 gallantry and other defense decorations to the armed forces personnel, as well as for the others. So 450 such awards have been approved by the President of India. Actually, a commanding officer of the 16th Bihar Regiment, right? He lost his life during the Galwan Valley clash, which was with the China last year. So posthumously, the Colonel B. Santosh Babu would be awarded Mahavir Chakra, right? So here, one such award is Mahavir Chakra. All right. So as I told you that every year, the government of India basically, you know, announce these awards, and these awards will be given, you know, twice in a year, right? The first is basically on the occasion of the Republic Day every year on the 26th of January. And the second is basically on the occasion of Independence Day on 15th of August. So these awards are basically given on 26th of January and 15th of August every year, right? And in order, the order of precedence, when you talk in terms of these awards, the Paramvir Chakra, right, which is the highest award, followed by Ashok Chakra, followed by, you know, the Mahavir Chakra, Kirti Chakra, Veer Chakra, and Shaurya Chakra. So the, it is the basically order of precedence of these awards. And regarding the constitution of these awards, so first of all, three gallantry award, which was constituted, which was instituted by the government of India on 26th of January 1950 itself, right, are the Paramvir Chakra, right, the Mahavir Chakra, and Veer Chakra. So these awards was, you know, constituted or instituted by the government of India on 26th of January 1950, okay, and thereafter three more gallantry awards were basically instituted: the Ashok Chakra Class 1, okay, the Ashok Chakra Class 2, and Ashok Chakra Class 3 in 1952, right? But what happens is, in 1967, these awards were renamed, or these awards were renamed. So they were renamed as Ashok Chakra, right, instead of Ashok Chakra Class 1, the Kirti Chakra instead of Ashok Chakra Class 2, and Shaurya Chakra instead of the Ashok Chakra Class 3, right? So here you have right now the six gallantry awards: Paramvir Chakra, Mahavir Chakra, and the Veer Chakra. And you have the Ashok Chakra, Kirti Chakra, and Shaurya Chakra, right? So you have six such gallantry awards which will be given, right, to, you know, to our soldiers. All right. So here you have the Colonel, you know, B.K. Mulla Santosh Babu, who was basically a commanding officer of the 16th Bihar Regiment. And he was basically posthumously, or he would be posthumously awarded the Mahavir Chakra, right, on the occasion of 26th of January 2021. All right. So here you have this news. All right. Let's understand the next news, that is Bharat Parv. Bharat Parv. So Bharat Parv 2021, right? It is a festival, first of all. Obviously, the Parv means, in the, it is the Hindi word Parv. Parv means it is a festival. Right, it is a festival to celebrate the spirit of India. Right, what is that means? Spirit of India. That means you have to celebrate every spirit, right, within India. That means you need to celebrate the patriotism. You need to celebrate, you know, the rich cultural diversity. You need to celebrate, right, every other aspect which basically unites the India, right, in the single thread. So that is something which is related to the spirit of India. So that Bharat Parv festival, right, would commence on, you know, 26th of January, right, already commenced. And it will be a, you know, it will be a 5-day event, first of all, from 26th of January till 31st of December 2021. So it is a 5-day festival, and it is not, you know, the physical festival, but it is a festival which will be organized on the virtual platform. Now you must understand, the virtual platform ID is www.bharatparv2021.com. So on the virtual platform, the Bharat Parv festival would be celebrated. So it is a part of every year's celebration. It is a part of, you know, a Republic Day celebrations since 2016. So every year, as a part of Republic Day celebration since 2016 onward, this 5-day festival is celebrated every year. And here you must understand, the ultimate objective is to generate, as I told you, the patriotic fervor, the promoting rich cultural diversity of the country, right, as well as to popularize the idea of Ek Bharat Shreshth Bharat, right? So ultimate aim was to generate the sense of patriotism, right, to promote the rich cultural diversity, and to cherish, you know, the unity in the diversity. For that, this Bharat Parv festival would be celebrated. And this festival would be organized by the Ministry of Tourism in the collaboration of various central ministries, right? And here it is a 5-day event with from 26th of January to 31st of January 2019. So it is a part of the Republic Day celebration. Okay, so you can see it is a logo of the Bharat Parv. You can check out this website and you can find out more information about the Bharat Parv. Okay, next, the NVVN Limited. Okay, so first of all, the NVVN is nothing but the NTPC Vidyut Vyapar Nigam Limited. So it is the NTPC Vidyut Vyapar All right. So you have NVVN Limited. So as I told you that it is basically the NTPC Vidyut Vyapar Nigam Limited, right? So Vidyut Vyapar Nigam Limited. So it is basically 100%, right? 100%, you know, subsidiary company which is owned by NTPC or National Thermal Power Corporation Limited, which is a PSU under Ministry of Power, right? So it is basically a 100% subsidiary of NTPC Limited. And its main purpose of creation of this NVVN Limited is to provide some sort of a last mile connectivity, right, with the electric buses or the fleet of electric buses. So here, the Lieutenant Governor of Andaman and Nicobar Islands basically flagged off this fleet of electric buses here. All right. So here, the news basically related to the Andaman and Nicobar Islands, where the fleet of bus or electric bus basically have been flagged off by the Lieutenant Governor, right? So here, the introduction of this electric buses in the island union territory would definitely help to cut down the tailpipe emissions, right, as well as the comfortable public transport. So you must understand, because Andaman and Nicobar Islands basically, it is basically also, you know, having the high diversity, biodiversity, as well as it is an island, it is an island. So here the consideration is basically to cut down those emissions, which is basically related to carbon dioxide, methane, nitrous oxide, right? So here to cut down those emissions as well as to provide some sort of a comfortable journey to the public. And here the project basically consisting of 40 electric buses, which will be executed, right, by NTPC Vidyut Vyapar Nigam Limited, which is NVVN Limited, which is a nothing but 100% subsidiary of NTPC Limited, right, which is a PSU under the Government of India, or which is a PSU under Ministry of Power, Government of India, right? And in addition to providing this, you know, the fleet of 40 electric buses to the Andaman and Nicobar Islands, right, NVVN Limited is also one, right, or emerged a successful bidder for providing a turnkey solution for 90 electric buses fleet for the Bengaluru under Smart City project, right? So here the NVVN Limited would be providing the 90 such electric buses for the Bengaluru city under the Smart City project. And that will provide ultimately the last mile connectivity to the Namma Metro network, right? So it will be providing a last mile connectivity to Namma Metro network. And NVVN is basically developing and providing a complete range of zero emission mobility solution to the various vehicle segments. So here, the zero emission mobility solutions will be provided ultimately, because electric vehicles don't emit anthropogenic gases like carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrous oxide. So obviously, the zero emission mobility will be provided by these electric buses, right, which will have the most important solution for your, for your transport. Right. Next, the Manjama Jagoti, right? So Manjama Jagoti is basically a transgender, right? From it is the name for a transgender from Karnataka, right? Who would be awarded the Padam, Padam Shri, right? Who would be awarded, right, a Padam, award this year, right? So it is basically, or this transgender would be included in the Padam award this year, would be conferred, right, from Karnataka, right, because he is, or this transgender basically is practicing, or single-handedly popularizing this rural folk arts, especially in the regions of Karnataka. So here the Padam Shri would be awarded to Manjama Jagoti. The Manjama Jagoti is a transgender, right? The transgender was working basically for the decades for the social and the financial struggle. Despite of their social and financial struggle, right, the Manjama Jagoti was involved in the popularizing of this rural folk arts, especially in the Karnataka, like Jogati Nritya, as well as the Janapada songs, which are popularized by this transgender, especially in the rural Karnataka, Maharashtra, and the parts of Andhra Pradesh. Regarding background, she was basically identified as a woman in her teen, right? And second is basically her family basically belongs to the Bellary district of Karnataka, and her family basically disowned her by making her part to the transgender community, right, because she was a transgender, especially in the rural Deccan, and they basically considered the goddess Renuka Yelamma, right, and members of this community also considered to be married to this goddess. and the community lifestyle in the plight of this member, all right, which is a part of your transgender, but highlighted in the national award winning 2009 Marathi movie Jogwa. So Jogwa movie was basically based on this community's lifestyle. Okay, next, Marut. So Marut is basically, you know, it is a fighter plane which is indigenously built, indigenously developed, indigenously designed. So it is India's first indigenously designed and developed fighter aircraft. So why it is in news? So here there is Nehru Science Center, which is basically located in Mumbai. So here the Nehru Science Center basically, would have certain set of artifacts, right? So these artifacts will be placed, right, in this science center, and which will be open to the public for the visitors, right? So here these artifacts, which are related to the rail locomotives, which are related to the fighter planes like Marut, would be given to the public for their viewing purpose, right? So it will be available for the public viewing, right? All such artifacts which are related to the rail or the fighter planes. So here the most important point is certain set of locomotives and as well as the Marut would be placed for the public viewing. So India's first indigenously designed and developed fighter aircraft, the Marut, will now be available for the public viewing, especially in the Nehru Science Center, Mumbai. And the second, the most important is DC electric loco, which is named as this one. So 224 NV CP2, which was basically commissioned in 1938, right, during the British period, and as a part of the Great Indian Peninsula Railway. And this, you know, DC electric loco was used to haul the passenger train, right? So it is basically a loco, right? You must understand, it's an electric loco which used to, haul the passenger trains, on especially on the Kalyan Pune section, right, in the Deccan region for 40 years, right? And in this, in these 40 years, this DC electric loco, which was having the distinction of hauling the prestigious Deccan Queen from Mumbai to Pune also. So it has that, distinction to have. And the second, basically, the loco is basically this DC electric loco number. This one is one of the India's first electric locomotives inducted into the service after introduction of electric traction in the Indian subcontinent. So it is also having this much, distinction to be given to the public for their viewing. And it is basically Marut. You can see here, it is basically first indigenously designed and developed the fighter aircraft, which are, developed by India. All right. So thank you very much for attending this session. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next news. So thank you very much. Thank you.